HDInsight introduced a new feature called auto-scaling. It enables you to make the best of your budget, and Alicia is here to tell us all about it today on Data Exposed. Hi, and welcome to another episode of Data Exposed. I'm excited to be here today with Alicia, who's joining me from the HDInsight team. So, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Aaron. Thank you, everyone. I'm Alicia Li. I'm the product manager from Azure HDInsight product group.
Cool.
I have been working on the platform area. So, my goal is to make the platform most reliable and cost efficient for our customer to run the open source big data analytics.
Cool. So, I'm excited to have you here. Sounds like you have been working with HDInsight for a little bit, right?
Yeah, correct.
So what is the main feedback that you've been getting from our customers?
Yeah, well, the feedback that we got from customers is that they found it a bit challenging to control the cost.
Okay.
We know for the big data analytics, the per unit cost is low.
Okay.
But when the customer are running a lot, a lot, I mean, some customer, they may process petabyte of data, are running thousands of calls for hours, you may end up get a big bill by the end of the month.
Right, and it's kind of what you would expect. It's big data for a reason, right?
Yeah.
So it's going to be about processing a lot of data.
Yes, you are right. So how to control costs would be one of the major requirements for our big data customers.
Okay, cool.
So today, let's consider that the world of static clusters. So when I say the static cluster, I mean the size of the cluster is fixed.
Okay.
So why do customers need this kind of long-running static clusters? We have observed that our customers are running this kind of large, long-running clusters.
Okay.
When I say long-running cluster, I mean they are running this cluster running 24/7 every single day. And the cluster size is fixed.
Okay.
So why do customers need to do that? So through the engagement with the customer, we found that they have very complex configuration for the clusters, like embedded settings, like the ranger security policies.
Right.
Also, they will have a lot of custom applications to install in the clusters. So all of this make it very complicated for customer to recreate a brand new cluster.
Right. It would take a lot of time to destroy and then build this all up.
You are right.
So that's why they built this long-running big
good cluster.
Static cluster.
Yeah.
Okay.
You think about that. So the customer, it may take them a lot of time to build it. So it's very hard for them to recreate the cluster several times a day. So they have to keep this long running. And you think about when they provision this cluster, they have to make sure it can meet their job performance requirement.
Right.
So sometimes they have to land up provision for the peak usage.
Right.
But their load actually coming to this cluster is a variable.
Yeah.
So maybe more load during the working hour, or less load, or even no load in the non-working hour.
Right.
So this all leads to very low utilization for the customer cluster, which means there's a waste there.
Right. But this, I mean, I get this, right? If it's hard to build this cluster, you would want to do it once, and then you want to do it good. So you design this for peak. I get it. It doesn't sound very cloud-like, though.
You are right. That cloud is designed to be elastic.
Right.
Right. So what can we do to help our customers?
You probably have an answer for
that. Yeah, we heard the pain, and here is what we are doing.
Cool.
So we introduced the auto-scale capability.
Okay.
So where customers can let the service work for you. So all the customer need to do is to set the configurations.
Okay.
So for example, you can set the minimum and the maximum number of nodes for your cluster. Or you can set the schedule where you want to, at when you want to scale up and scale down of your cluster. After that, your job is done.
Awesome. Okay? So basically, I can now just tell whenever you need more resources, take more. Whenever you don't need them anymore, just take less resources. Is that what you're trying to do here?
Yeah, right.
Cool.
And the remaining is leave to us. The service will take care of that.
Okay.
So the service will monitor the CPU and the memory usage.
Right.
To see how much available resource right now I have, and then I compare with the pending task resource requirement. If my available is less than the requirement, then I will add more nodes, which means scale up.
Yep.
And if I have extra resources, then I will scale down. Okay. One more important thing here, or the complexity that we are trying to hide from our customer, is that how to ensure the job successful rate during the cluster scaling down.
Right. There's something happening, right? The system is busy scaling, and then you're still firing jobs. So how do you handle that?
Yeah, so we will, during our scale down, we will do a graceful scale down. So okay. we'll shift the data to the node that we decided to keep. And we will light the node to complete the current task. And then during the job queue, and smoothly remove that node silently. Okay. So that the job will continue to run until succeed.
Okay, so with this, basically as a customer, I get the best of both worlds, right? I get the cloud, I get the big data scaling that I need when I need it.
But yeah,
I don't overpay for just scaling at the peak all the time, as you explained we had to do before.
Yes, in this way you can see the high utilization of your cluster and you pay only for what you really need. So therefore, there's no waste anymore.
Cool.
So our customer has been using this feature for several months. So our customer told us they have saved up to 62%.
Wow.
We are very excited about this result.
62% saving, that's amazing for just, you know, an innovation like this. That's awesome. So cool. I can you show me how I use this?
Sure, let me show you.
Yeah.
Okay, so first let me show you how to create an HDInsight cluster with this autoscale capability.
Okay.
Okay, you go to Azure portal and then you create the resource. Then let's find HDInsight.
Yep.
Okay, now I want to create a new cluster.
Sure.
So let's say I want to create this cluster to do the business analytics. When I say business analytics, that I want to analyze the usage of my customer, my business, the growth of my customer, all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And the same as the normal step that you will select solution, resource group, and then now let's give the name. Let's say the business analytics.
Let's see if that name hasn't been taken
yet. It's spinning.
I always have this problem that when I do this, that the name is already taken.
It means you choose a popular name.
Yeah, probably.
Let me, now I got this name.
There you go, like, perfect.
I choose the Spark cluster, and then let me give it a password.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's directly go to the configuration page.
Okay.
Okay, here you will see, this is a button. You can see enable autoscale. And here you will see two mode. Okay, one is load-based. Load-based, you need to specify the minimum that even when there's no load, how many nodes you want to keep there.
Right.
You can have a maximum when you have the peak node, how big you want your cluster to scale up to.
Right, so the minimum node is kind of keep the lights on idea, right? If there's nothing happening, at least this amount will be reserved for us so we have something.
Just in case something coming, you can work it directly.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And here it will give the estimation of the price. So you can see that with the minimum, you only pay $2.99 per hour, and the maximum you put $23. So think about, without this feature, the customer may have to line up and pay this much all the time.
Right.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
And there's another mode I do want to touch on that one. It's a schedule based. So this one works better, for example, if you have a data scientist team.
Okay.
You know they will come at 9 a.m., they start working, and 6 p.m., they go back home.
Okay.
So for this kind of scenario, you can you want to maybe set your cluster like this. I want to select Monday to Friday. Now, let me give them 30 node. And let's say at 6 p.m., let me give them 6 node.
Right.
Or even for the weekend, you can add another condition to say for the weekend.
You could say maybe 3 nodes or whatever.
Oh,
right?
Okay, yeah, you're right.
I mean, so it might be a data scientist working in the weekend. Who knows?
Could be,
right,
could be. So like leave 3 for them.
Yeah.
Then after this, then you can review the configuration and create your cluster as normal.
Cool. So this is very cool. And I like the way it's very clear to the customer where the setting is and what the impact on cost will be.
Yeah, it only takes them several seconds to set up. Then everything else is taken care of.
Wow, awesome. So that's how I start using this. Now, okay, let's imagine I have it, I'm running this. How can I monitor what's happening in the cluster? I mean, I want to be sure that the settings that I have are correct, right?
Yeah. So let me show, I already have two clusters running.
Okay.
So let me show you how I monitor it.
Yeah.
So let me start with this one. So this is the HDInsight cluster overview page, and then you scroll down. Here there's a monitoring section.
Mm-hmm.
You select metrics, and here you may want to see the active worker node. So by default, this is the past 24 hours. Let me go to, let's say, the past 3 days.
Okay. Yep.
Okay. So you can see when I have more load at the peak time, it goes to 10 node.
Right.
And when there's no load, it goes to 3.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
So this validates your assumption. Yeah, this autoscale actually worked for me, right? So let me show you quickly show another one. This is schedule-based, the same thing. You go to monitoring, go to the metrics-based. So this is something that we just discussed. Hey, I want to set up for my data scientist team. Let's see how it works. So you can see it form a pattern, right? And this definitely is the weekend.
Yep, it's a pretty pattern. I see exactly the settings that I make. They show up in this.
Right. This is very easy to validate.
Very cool.
If you after you evaluate this, you think, well, maybe I can still save more. I want to make some changes. You can always go to here, the cluster size, and here you can switch between this mode, and you can change the configuration, and you can enable or disable auto scale.
Right. So if for whatever reason, let's say I don't know, I know there's a big project coming up like the next 4 days, you could maybe even go back to not auto scale and just peak for a little bit, and then I can switch back to auto scale whenever
you
want to.
Yeah, and also you can for this kind of situation, you can change your configuration to provision for the peak and for the 24 hours, and then after the load is gone, the event is over, you can switch back.
Wow!
And you have the full flexibility.
That is very cool. This is so cool. So
thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure customers will love this. So is there any? And now that we know how it works and what it does and how I start using it, is there any best practices you can share for customers that want to get started?
Sure. I think one of the practices I want to share is that you may want to go back and forth to check, to validate, as I just showed, to validate actually your cluster size match with your requirement. So if you still see there's a waste, you can always adjust it.
Okay.
So further tune your settings. So that's the first piece of advice I want to give. The second one that I want to give is that, for example, if you are using this kind of schedule-based autoscale, that if you have the pipeline coming on the fixed time, let's say you know you already schedule a pipeline at 9 a.m. coming, you may want to give a buffer. Because when the system triggers the scale up, scale down, it has some latency there. So you may want to specify your load you may want to schedule the number of your cluster to 8:30, so that by 9 a.m. your load is coming, the cluster is ready to process.
Right, you're saying that whenever you expect the load to come in 30 minutes before that, make sure you already start scaling.
Yeah,
right?
Just give some buffer, maybe not 30 minutes, but at least give 10 to 20 minutes buffer.
Okay, cool. Those are really good tips. Thank you for that. And thanks a lot for being here. Thanks for sharing. I find this very exciting.
Okay.
And I think you find it very exciting too. So thanks for watching. Please like, subscribe, and comment. And I hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.